Hey guys, I'm Kelly with St. John's County Parks Recreation, and this is a talk I would normally give at our public libraries, but since we're closed down and we're hunkering down at home, I want to bring this talk to you in your home. And here's the best part. Unlike when you go to the library, you can show up today, watch my presentation in your pajamas. So today we're going to talk about living with snakes and gators, which is a reality of life in Florida. So first things first, who I am, what I do, where I work. I work for the county. So St. John's County is located in Florida in the St. Augustine area. Our county is really diverse and really cool. We run the gamut from the Atlantic Ocean to the St. John's River. With that wide variety of ecosystems, bring a whole different kind of group of reptiles in each different ecosystem. So I'm gonna touch today on snakes and gators and where they would fall in our ecosystems you would find in St. John's County. Now, specifically within the county, I work for the Parks and Rec Department. Parks and Rec Department's a really diverse department that's really dedicated to everything outdoors. So from walking trails, to your playgrounds, to your tennis courts, to your baseball fields, to your boat ramps, to your beach access points, our Parks and Rec Department is incredibly diverse and we provide a lot of services to the community. So where do I fit in all of this? Well, I'm the Parks Naturalist. And so as a Parks Naturalist, it is my job to bring education program to people, even if I can't be with you in person. So when this is all over and the sun is shining again and we can go back to being a community, come join me for a beach walk, come kayaking with me, come see this park in person. We're actually have live animals with me. And during this time, you know, soak up all this educational resources. I'll be here every Thursday giving talks on the St. John's County Library page. All right, so here we go. We're about to talk about snakes and alligators. If you have fears of snakes and alligators, my goal today is to replace your fear with respect, because these animals are awesome, and hopefully you'll walk away with a few new tips that you didn't know before about these amazing creatures. So first things first, we have snakes and we have alligators, but they're both part of this bigger group called reptiles, which means they all have certain characteristics in common, making them reptiles. So I want you to think for a second, what makes a reptile? Think about those things. So here's the deal, when I normally give this talk in person, it's very interactive and I make everybody participate. And I can't see you right now at home, but I'm envisioning you participating throughout this whole presentation. So when I ask you to think about something or pick an option, humor me and go ahead and pick it for me. So while I was talking, you were thinking about what made a reptile, let's see how many characteristics you got right. So we have one, that they're vertebrates. So they all have backbones, just like you and me. If you take two fingers and you run them along your back, along your spine there, we have a spinal cord. And then we have ribs that come off of our spinal cord. Snakes and alligators and turtles and every other reptile are the same exact way. So this picture here is of a snake vertebrae. You can see how long they are and how many ribs they have. They also have eggs. So in this case, these are turtle eggs. Most reptile eggs are leathery and soft. Some reptiles, even though they have eggs though, will hold those eggs inside and wait for them to basically hatch internally. So they're not connected to mom, but they do still give a form of live birth. They have scales, so not just snakes, all reptiles have some form of snails. Snails are a different topic for another day. They're cold-blooded. So what this means is they're the opposite of us. So we are warm-blooded, meaning we eat three meals a day, dessert, snack, midnight snack, all in the name of maintaining a constant body temperature, right? That's the only reason we eat all those delicious. Well, if you're cold-blooded, you derive your energy from the sun, from the warmth outside, which means our reptiles are really active in the summertime when the sun is shining and the temperature is really high. When it's cold and maybe rainy and cloudy, they're not as active because they're cold-blooded. And I know this seems like common sense, but I want to put this in here. They breathe air. So even our alligator friends and our turtle friends who spend a lot of time underwater, they still have lungs like you and me. So just like when we go to the swimming pool and we have to hold our breath underwater, that's exactly what they're doing too. they're just a lot better at it than we are. All right, so we're gonna start off with snakes. My personal favorite, slightly biased, but they're really cool. And so I'm gonna start off with some basic facts. Let's all get on the same page. Snakes are carnivores. There are no snakes out there looking for a delicious salad. I'm not really looking for a delicious salad either, so I can relate. But yeah, they're carnivores. They don't have any eyelids. They're always staring at you. So never get into a staring contest with a snake. Instead of eyelids, they have these special scales over their eyes. You guys can see this is a snake skin. And right where that head would be, you can see those scales. So those scales over their eyes protect their eyes. And when they shed, as you saw in that skin there, that special scale goes with the rest of the shed. So right before they're about to shed, their eyes actually get really cloudy and blue, and it makes it hard for them to see. So usually when they're about to shed, they're hiding somewhere because their eyesight's not very good and they get startled really easily. They don't have big, flappy external ears. That'd be super silly to have a snake with giant ears. They have the ability to unhinge their lower jaw. This allows them to eat things three times the size of their head. So they make their jaw really big, they open up that head, and they just swallow their food down whole. Sometimes if it's really big, you can actually follow in the snake where that food is moving, because there's this bulge moving through its body. Really neat, I know. The other thing is that snakes are found on every large landmass, so every continent except for Antarctica. There are a few islands that do not have snakes, but every large landmass does have snakes. Snakes smell with their tongue. Crazy. So when they're flicking that tongue in and out, their tongue is forked. And that forked tongue allows them to sense the direction in which the smell is coming from. And every single snake species have some basic ability to swim. So some snakes hate the water. They want nothing to do with it. They will get from one side of a puddle to another if they have to. And other snakes will just spend all day, every day in the water, swimming laps. We'll talk about a couple of those snakes. So this is another part where you're gonna participate, and we're gonna pretend like you're participating the whole time. How many different snake species live in Florida? When I ask this question, I get lots of different numbers. I'm looking for the different kinds of snakes. So not how many individual snakes, but how many different kinds of snakes are in Florida. Think about it. Think about it. Get those answers. If you're watching with multiple people, see who's closest. Ready? 45. There are 45 native species of snake in the state of Florida, six of which are venomous, and then there's an additional five that are exotic. So what do I mean when I say exotic? All I simply mean is they're not from Florida. They are not from here. They are from somewhere else, but some of them are thriving here, like this picture on the right. Do you guys see this long picture that these two guys, or this snake that these two guys are handling? Anybody know what kind of snake that is? You're all right, because I'm just going to assume that you all said that they're all a Burmese python. These Burmese pythons are gigantic. They can be up to 20 feet long. That's huge, okay? And these snakes are decimating small mammal populations in the Everglades. They're eating all of your raccoons, all of your small mice, all of your rabbits. They're even eating small deer, some of the big ones. And so these snakes are no good. So FWC has lots of removal programs in place. In fact, when the Super Bowl this last February was held in Miami, they had a snake bowl to capture these snakes, where they had like 750 people who participated in capturing these Burmese pythons. Now up here in Northeast Florida, we don't have to worry about them yet. They're not here. Always a chance they could make it here. This is the one time in your life to be super thankful for I-4, because even if they start to move north in Florida, I-4 can be hard to drive in, let alone cross. So we just have to hope if they make it that far north, just hopefully don't make it across I-4. That's the last we're going to talk about our invasive species of snakes. I'm going to move on to some of the snakes that you would see in your backyard that are non-venomous. I'll get to those venomous, though, I promise. So So two or three technically of the most common backyard snakes that you're going to see are your black racers. Those are those really fast snakes zooming across the sidewalks, all black, long, slender bodies. They can be about 5 feet long. They're not unique to Florida. They're all the way from the Keys down up to Maine. And then two other snakes that are kinds of a rat snake are the yellow rat snake and the red rat snake. These guys can get to be about 6 feet long. They're really good climbers. They have super special belly muscles that allow them to be able to climb trees and kind of go up and look for things like eggs. Now, our yellow snakes are sometimes called chicken snakes because they're found in chicken coops. And the red corn snake, also known as the red rat snake, were oftentimes found in cornfields eating on the mice that were eating the corn. So we don't necessarily see that as much today. Most of us don't live on farms anymore, but I have a friend who does. And look what she found in her chicken coop the other day. So, unassuming chicken. And right next to this chicken is a huge yellow chicken snake or yellow rat snake. Look at this guy. He's just staring at her. He's like, what? I got my eggs. I'm good. I'm just going to lay here. This guy's an adult. Super cool. She lets him steal an egg every now and again, and he keeps the rat out. So they've got a pretty good relationship. Two other common snakes that we have in this area that you may find, but are cool if you do, are eastern garter snakes. They're smaller. They're only about 2 feet long, but they're one of the live-bearing snakes I told you about. So they don't leave their eggs out and about exposed. Actually hold those eggs inside, and then once those eggs hatch, they give live birth. These guys are found on the edges of ditches and ponds. They're not necessarily in the water, but they like to be right along the water. The next one I've personally handled and had some experience with, it's the southern ringneck snake. These guys are less than a foot long. They're super tiny. But you'll find them a lot in uncaged pools because they fall in and they can't get back out because they're so tiny. You also find them in those utility boxes where your shutoff valves are. So these guys are really cool and they're really pretty. So when they're threatened, they coil up and they turn their bottoms over like this picture shows. So they're super bright. And in nature, these colors mean warning, 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 I'm dangerous. He's not dangerous. He just wants you to think he's dangerous. And if that doesn't work, he's hoping you're going to target that tail and he can get away with his head. But these guys are really cool. None of these snakes are anything to be scared of or worried about. Now, the next snake that I'm going to talk about is one of the coolest snakes that we have here in the state of Florida. That is the eastern indigo snake. These things are huge. 6 feet. 6 feet long. That's taller than me. That's huge. These guys are found where it is high and dry. They like to utilize gopher tortoise burrows, actually where I saw my first eastern indigo snake. I about freaked out. I was taking a group out on a tour and some lady said, hey, is that a black racer? And it was sitting right there on the top of a gopher tortoise burrow. And I looked at it and I was like, oh my gosh, it's an eastern indigo snake. I got so excited. These things are so rare, guys. They're federally listed as threatened. There are not many of them left. It was right there above the gopher tortoise burrow, and then it went right back inside. If you ever see any of these, or you have any of these on your property, you cannot touch them. They are federally protected. I just want to stress that. You really shouldn't be touching any snake, but you definitely don't want to touch this one. What's really cool, and the reason you're going to want to keep it around if you do have one, is that these guys actually eat other snakes, including venomous snakes. You guys see this picture here? This picture here is a rattlesnake tail hanging out of an eastern indigo snake's mouth. So freaking cool. All right, so now we've covered some of our non-venomous snakes. Like I said, there are a lot more than what I covered. Just doing some highlights here. If you guys have any specific questions, you can always reach out and ask me. So next we're going to cover venomous snakes. But before we do that, I want to make a really, really important distinction because I get asked this question all the time. Do we have any poisonous snakes in Florida? No, because we're not running around eating them. Okay? Poison is something you eat. You eat it like food poisoning and you get sick and you got to spend the rest of the night near the bathroom. That's poisoning. We're not running around eating snakes. When we're talking about snakes that are potentially dangerous, they're venomous. They have fangs in their mouth that inject venom into you. All right, that's what we're talking about here. That's what those snakes have. So in Florida, we have venomous snakes. We don't have poisonous snakes, okay? Just a pet peeve of mine. All of you after watching this video will never make that mistake again. You're gonna be super smart. Okay, so let's take a closer look at those venomous snakes. Like I said, we have six of them in Florida, but only four of them are really found in the northeastern Florida area, especially in St. John's County. So the top four on your screen here, your coral snake, your water moccasin, your diamondback rattlesnake, and your pygmy rattlesnake, all are found in St. John's County. Your copperheads and your timber rattlesnakes, they're really found at the Florida-Georgia line, closer to the panhandle. None of them have been documented here in St. John's County. So we'll take a closer look at all four of these. But before we do, I want to test your ability to identify the venomous snake. So one of these is venomous, one of these is non-venomous. I want you to take a look. I want you to take a guess, all right? Pretend like we're in person here, humor me. A or B, which one is the venomous snake? Okay, ready? You got your answer? A is your venomous snake. So A is a coral snake, red on yellow, kill a fellow, red on black, friend of Jack. So that friend of Jack, and B is a scarlet king snake. Scarlet king snakes are hoping that you actually think they're venomous. It's called mimicry. They're hoping to benefit from the same or similar banding pattern of the coral snake. And by doing that, predators will think twice about trying to eat them. In the normal animal kingdom, that works out great. In a kingdom where humans are on top and they're really scared of snakes, not so great usually. But let's take a closer look at that coral snake, and both of these are native to Florida. So the eastern coral snake is about 2 to 3 feet long, and three is kind of a big coral snake. They're usually small. They like to be in upland habitats. They want to be where it's high and dry. They're going to be near your eastern indigo snakes, near your gopher tortoises. These guys are nocturnal, which is sort of rare for snakes. Usually they're active during the day once it's warmed up. And unlike the other three venomous snakes we have here in St. John's County, which are all in the pit viper family, which we'll talk about in a minute, these guys have fixed fangs. So their fangs are always down, are always ready to strike. Our pit vipers have retractable fangs that they can put down when they need them. These guys' heads are super tiny, so they're a small snake to begin with, and they have fixed fangs, but those fangs are really far back in their mouth. And so no one has died from a coral bite snake since the 1960s. In fact, they've actually stopped making the anti-venom, because in order for you to get venom injected into you from a coral snake, you more or less have to let that snake gnaw on you. Now, I love snakes. In case you can't tell, I'm kind of a snake person. I think they're really cool. But I'm not gonna let a snake gnaw on me, right? So not too much to worry about here. These snakes you will find in your debris piles that are high and dry. And if you see one, I wanna know about it, because I have never, ever, ever seen one of these snakes. It's on my list of species to find out in the wild. All right, so we've got the coral snake. Let's move into the pit viper family. And once again, you're gonna participate. I know you're participating at home. And take a look at these two pictures. One is venomous, one is non-venomous. Both are native to Florida. So which one is venomous, A or B? Okay, got your answers? Ready? The venomous snake is B. So those of you that got B, you got it right. Those of you that guessed A, well, got it wrong. Better luck at the next one. A is your banded water snake. So these guys live in the same exact habitat as a cottonmouth, and they are so often commonly misidentified as cottonmouths. These guys, one of the distinctive differences is that tail. Take a look at the tail on that guy. See how it's really long and slender? Whereas the one on B, the body is really fat and is
body goes from being really fat to really skinny really quickly. Now, if you're close enough to the snake to be looking at whether or not the tail is skinny or fat, you need to back up from the snake, okay? So the banded water snake's on the left and the cottonmouth on the right. So let's take a closer look at that cottonmouth. Cottonmouth, also known as water moccasin, gets its name from this behavior it does when it's threatened. It will actually curl itself up and open that mouth that is pearly white, hence the cottonmouth name. Now you can get a better look at the tail on this picture. You can see how it goes from being really fat to really skinny almost abruptly. These guys can be 2 to 4, 6 feet long. We talked about how they're in the pit viper family, but what the heck does that mean? Well, it means that they have these heat-sensing pits in the front of their face that allow them to detect changes in heat, and they utilize that as a tool to help them hunt. These guys love to be where it's wet. They want to be in the water, around the water, near the water. That's where you're going to find cottonmouths. These guys are highly variable in coloration. So just like I have dark brown hair and you may have blonde hair or red hair or gray hair, the snakes come in all sorts of different colors too. So they'll be totally brown, totally black, some banding, distinctive banding, faded banding, no banding. So there's a wide variation for both them and the banded water snake, which is where things get really confusing. So almost anytime anybody sees a brownish snake by the water, somehow it's automatically always a cottonmouth. And I hear all these stories of people being chased by cottonmouths. Well, I'll tell you what, I spend almost all of my days outside hanging out where the snakes are hanging out, and I've never, ever once been chased by any kind of snake, but especially not a cottonmouth. Now, some people say that we do have copperheads here. And the misconception comes from the coloration of the cottonmouth juvenile coloration. So if you look at this picture here, the juvenile cottonmouths can sometimes look like copperheads. But according to the maps and the latest data I could find, we do not have copperheads here in St. John's County. All right, you ready? If you haven't gotten any right, now is your chance, okay? Which one of these is the venomous snake? One is venomous, one is non-venomous. Both of them live in Florida. Take a look, A or B, which one's the venomous one? Do, 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 do. Okay, got your answer? So if you guessed B, you're incorrect. The correct answer is A. A is a pygmy rattlesnake. B is actually a juvenile black racer, which can have banding patterns similar to the pygmy rattlesnake. So the pygmy rattlesnake is a tiny snake, about 2 feet long, also in the pit viper family. These guys don't care what the habitat's like. High, dry, near water, in water, around water, doesn't matter. They're everywhere. These guys are what we call viviparous. They're one of those ones that give live birth, that hold those eggs internally. Now, if you think of a rattlesnake, you think of probably a big rattlesnake with a really loud rattle. Not so much with these guys. These guys will take that teeny tiny rattle and they'll rattle it. And that rattle sounds kind of like an insect. And so they'll rattle, rattle, rattle. And they'll wait for like a lizard to come along and think, tasty insect lunch. And they'll go to bite the tail. In the same time that's happening, the head of the snake will whip around and the snake will get lunch. Pretty cool. And it's an old wives' tale, but you can't count the rattles on the end of the snake to tell the size or the age of the snake. And if you are close enough to a snake to count the individual rattles on the tail of a snake, you need to back up. You are way too close. Got it? Moving on to the snake that cannot be confused for any other, because it is just so impressive that I can't even compare it to anything else that lives in Florida. That is the Eastern Diamondback Rattlesnake. Of all the venomous snakes, this is my favorite. I've had multiple encounters with this snake. All of them were so cool. In fact, I once had a professor who was a herpetologist, highly trained to handle snakes. We were doing studies on snakes, okay? So we were supposed to be capturing them and touching them, not me as in we, him as in we. And he darted off into the bushes, total Steve Irwin moved, come back with this juvenile Easternback Diamondback rattlesnake. I got to feel it rattle on my hands. Do you know how cool that is? It was so amazing. Don't do that at home. Don't touch the snakes. Don't capture the snakes. It was for research purposes only. He was highly, highly trained in handling venomous snakes, but it was cool, was my point of that story. Okay, so these guys can be up to 6 feet long. They are the largest venomous rattlesnake in the state of Florida. They too are in the pit viper families, and they want to be high and dry. They also will utilize those gopher tortoise burrows, so you'll find them around where the eastern indigo snakes are. They too rattle, but when they're rattling, they're warning you. Back it on up, Jack. And these guys have a long striking distance. They can strike up to 2/3 the length of their body. So if you've never heard a rattlesnake rattle before, I'm going to show you this video of some people who have made a rattlesnake really mad. Don't do this. All right, so that is an example of a rattlesnake rattling. Pretty cool. That rattlesnake was really mad. Don't make a rattlesnake mad, but thank him if he does rattle at you, because that rattlesnake is giving you a warning. That rattlesnake wants nothing to do with you. That rattlesnake just wants to be left alone. That rattlesnake can't eat you, so he doesn't want to waste his venom on you. And so if you ever see a rattlesnake rattling, just say, thanks, man. I see you. I'm going to go over here now. Okay? So I want to put some snake bites into perspective, because we have this huge fear of snakes, but really the stats say we don't have a whole lot to be scared of. So the vast majority, like 80 to 90% of snake bites, occur after we've messed with the snake. In fact, most of the snake bites are in the upper half of the body and are in men. I will let you infer what that means. But basically, when usually we see a snake, we call up our boyfriend, our husband, our brother, our dad, our neighbor, some guy, usually. And we say, get rid of it. So what's their response? Well, usually they try to capture it or kill it. Neither of those are good ideas. And then that's when they get bit, when they're trying to handle the snake. Almost never, like incredibly rarely, are people just walking along and they get bit by a snake. Do you know how many hours I spend outside tromping through the woods, off trail in these crazy places? I have never once had a snake try to bite me just because I was walking in the woods. In fact, I rarely see snakes because most of the time I'm making so much noise that they've already scattered. So some more snake bite statistics for you. Rattlesnakes are responsible for more snake bites a year than any other venomous species of snake. Approximately 8,000 venomous snake bites occur every year in the United States. Little perspective, that's not that many people. Think of how many people live in the US. 1 in every 50 million people are likely to die from a snake bite, and you are 9 times more likely to be struck by lightning. Guys, we live in the lightning capital of the United States. We should be more terrified of lightning than we should be of snakes. About 20 to 25 of all pit viper bites are dry bites, meaning that they bite, but they don't inject venom. 50% of coral snake bites are also dry bites. Remember, because those fangs are really far back in their mouth. Keep in mind that dead snakes can bite too. So not only do we not want to kill the snake, because in the process of killing the snake is when we're probably going to get bit, but even after they're dead, they can bite you. There was a story from 2018 of a man in Texas who caught what was the equivalent of our eastern diamondback rattlesnake today. Western diamondback rattlesnake, because it's on the other side of the Mississippi River. And he went to go hold that sucker up for a picture after he took the head off. And guess what? That snake had muscle memory and it bit him and he ended up in the hospital. So we just need to leave snakes alone is the moral of the story. So there's a chart here that talks about United States fatality statistics, okay? And it looks at basically everything we should be more scared of dying from than snakes. So snake bites, about 6 people a year die from a snake bite in the United States. More people die from spider bite attacks, dog attacks, bees, lightning. Once again, lightning, guys, we live in Florida. We should be more terrified of lightning. Cars and lung cancer, all right? So some perspective. I know they may give us the heebie-jeebies, but it doesn't mean we need to be scared of them or try to kill them. So some tips for living with snakes, if you're like this guy and you come home and they just show up on your front door, just leave them alone. I couldn't tell you the number of times I've walked outside my front door and I've had a pygmy rattlesnake just hanging out right there. I just say good morning, sidestep him, and go on about my business, and he's gone by the time I come home. So you want to give snakes their space. Never, ever corner a snake. So in the wintertime, when it gets colder, a lot of people end up with snakes in their garage because we have warm things in our garage. Our garage is warm. We have hot water heaters. Out near our garage, we might have a pool pump. If you're trying to get rid of that snake, you can take a long-handled broom and coax them towards the exit. Never coax them towards a corner. You put something in a corner, it's going to fight, including me. But I've got hands. I can punch you. I've got legs. I can kick you. Snake doesn't have hands or arms or legs. So what is their only defense? To bite you. So go ahead and don't pressure them into a corner because they'll get defensive, just like if you backed me into a corner. Don't attempt to kill them. There's really no reason we should be handling snakes at all. And there's definitely no reason we should be killing snakes. Snakes are an integral part of our ecosystems. They play a really, really important role in keeping our food webs in balance. I say snake proof your yard, but I really mean is lesser your chances of having your snake in your yard. There really is no foolproof solution. I'm sorry. Trim your overgrown shrubs anywhere that they would want to hide. Keep your grass mowed because if it gets tall, they're going to want to hang out in it. Give them an area that they can hang out in because before all of our houses were built and all of our businesses were built, they had free reign to live wherever they wanted. And if they could just maybe get the edge of your pond around your yard, you just had a no-mow zone that they could hang out and claim as theirs, then maybe they won't be hanging up by your house. And remove brush piles or just be more cautious and aware that if you have firewood stacked up or you have leaves raked into a pile or any sort of debris piled somewhere, especially in the wintertime, that's where the snakes are going to hide out. So just be cautious. If you're going out and you're weary that there might be snakes around, make noise. Snakes want nothing to do with people. They're absolutely terrified of us. Just make a lot of noise and those snakes will be on their way. All right, so we're going to move on from snakes to alligators. And I've got some alligator facts for you. But first, back to identification. If you got nothing right in the snakes, now's your chance. You got 2 more tries. So we in the state of Florida have both alligators and crocodiles. Can you guys tell the difference between which one's an alligator and which one's the American crocodile? Take a look. One of these is the alligator, one of these is the crocodile. Okay. You guessed that A was the American alligator. Bingo! B is the American crocodile. Now, it seems somewhat obvious when they're adults, so you probably got that one right. But can you tell me a difference when they're babies? So one of these is a baby American alligator. One of these is a baby caiman, which is the only exotic species of crocodilian we have populations of in Florida. And one of these is an American crocodile. So take a look. Figure out which one's the alligator. Okay, ready? So A is the American alligator. So if you guess A, you're right. If you guess B or C, you're wrong. B is our crocodile and C is our one exotic species of caiman we have here in the state of Florida. So now here's the next question for you all. How can you tell the difference between an alligator and a crocodile? There's tons of different ways, but there is one foolproof way to tell the difference between an alligator and a crocodile. Do you guys know what it is? All right, well, let's see if you got it right. This is literally the best way to tell if it's an alligator or a crocodile. Let's see if you knew. And for those of you who don't want to read the slide, it says, it's easy to tell the difference between an alligator and a crocodile. One will see you later, and the other will see you in a while. Jokes, guys. Humor is the only way to get through this, okay? Just bear with me. Okay, for real, back to the info. Some distinctive differences between our American alligator and our American crocodile. Our crocodilian species are going to be tan and green, where our alligator species are going to be more black, really dark green. Crocodiles' heads are going to be really narrow and pointy, and alligator's heads are going to be wide and broad. So I actually have an alligator skull with me. I want you guys to take a look. Do you guys see how large this snout is and how it comes to a U shape at the bottom? If this was a crocodile, this would be really pointy and narrow. Our American alligator or American crocodile species pretty much are only going to eat fish, more or less. That's going to make up the bulk of their diet. Whereas the American alligators, man, if it fits in their mouth and it's not too hard to work for, that's what they're going to eat. When they're teeny tiny, they eat tiny stuff like insects and tiny fish and like little turtles and things. And as they get bigger, so even this guy, even though he's huge, look how big his head is. Something this big would still eat all that tiny stuff. Their diet just gets more inclusive as they get older. They never really take anything out of their diet. They're just always continually adding. And they want to work as little as possible. So we talked about these species being cold-blooded, and that they get their energy from the heat and the sun around them. Well, that means they don't have to eat as much. So an alligator, an American alligator, can survive on about the equivalent of a sandwich for about 2 weeks. And if they have a super fat tail that has lots of reserves, they could potentially go a whole year without eating. In our snake species, I've got a corn snake. That thing, he eats one mouse every 10 to 14 days or so. Sometimes she's gone 3 months without eating. Totally normal, totally healthy snake. So these guys, none of these reptiles are out there just, I must eat everything in sight. Not happening. That's why sometimes you can see an alligator just hanging out along the bank with some birds, maybe with the turtle, and you're like, wow, those must be some really trustworthy birds. No, the alligator's probably just not hungry. The habitats in which crocodiles and alligators live in, sorry, I got on a little bit of a tangent, we're going to focus now. So the crocodiles live in what we call brackish water, which is a mixture of fresh and salt water. They live in South Florida near the Everglades. Alligators live in fresh water. That's where they're going to spend the vast majority of their time. That's not to say they won't be found in brackish water or even sometimes in the ocean, but it's pretty rare. Usually they're just passing through or they got lost, but they're going to spend most of their time in freshwater. Our crocodilian American alligator, or crocodilian, oh my goodness, our crocodilians here in Florida don't really have parental care. They leave a nest, they leave an egg, they wish them luck, they go around their business. There are other crocodilian species around the world that do have parental care, but our American crocodiles, not so much. Our American alligators, on the other hand, are like awesome parents in the reptilian world. These guys will stay with their young for about 2 years, and we're coming up on mating and breeding season, and so that's when they're a lot more active and a lot more vocal. So some basic American alligator facts: they can be 10 to 15 feet long, they can weigh 400 to 1,000 pounds, they can continue to grow throughout their lifetime, they really don't ever stop growing, they're always getting bigger every year. They're found from North Carolina, around the Florida coast, and over to Texas. There's about a total of 5 million alligators in the United States. They're an endangered species success story. They were on the brink of extinction, and now there's 5 million of them. In fact, about 1.5 to 2 million of them reside in the state of Florida. These guys, just like our snakes, don't want a salad. They want some meat. They are carnivores. They're the last of the living reptiles that were closely related to dinosaurs. They have two sets of eyelids, which I'll show you a video of in a second. They can go through 3,000 teeth in their lifetime. So sharks get a rap for having really cool teeth, right? Tons of teeth. Everybody knows that sharks have lots of teeth. But for some reason, a lot of people don't know that alligators go through over 3,000 teeth in their lifetime. So alligator teeth, which is what I have here, they're stacked together like ice cream cones. And when that bottom tooth falls out, there's another tooth right behind it ready to go. And they use tools to draw and prey. So let's watch the video next of the second set of eyelids, because that's really cool. Because they have a set of eyelids like you and I, where they blink, light, dark, light, dark, light, dark. And then they have a special set that goes side to side. Ooh, there it goes. Did you see it? It's gonna go again. Ready? That is called the nictitating membrane. The nictitating membrane are like underwater goggles for alligators. How cool would it be to have built-in underwater goggles? That's what they have. It's called the nictitating membrane. Awesome. Okay, so the next video I'm going to show you, I am warning you, if you are watching with children, this shows the circle of life. Everybody's got to eat. Okay, fair warning on this one. This is from National Geographic's American National Park series, where they highlighted the Everglades, and one of the segments was on alligators. So sit back, relax, enjoy.
It's a bit crowded at the best South Florida restaurants, but the menu makes it worth it. For the exceptionally clever alligator, there may be a rare and very special item on the menu. It's breeding time for the egrets. The birds are so tantalizingly close, the alligators can practically taste them. The egrets are busy nest building and quite picky about their construction materials. Somehow the occasional alligator can be seen floating around balancing a stick perfectly on his nose. Is it just coincidence? Or is this 400-pound reptile with a brain the size of a walnut a master of deception? The egret apparently has eyes only for the stick. And the alligator has snagged the chef's special. This amazing strategy, or wild stroke of luck, has been seen here, but never filmed before.
I'm sorry, that was super neat. Did you guys catch in that video the size of an alligator's brain? Yeah, you totally got it right. The size of a walnut, okay? On this skull that I have, this part right here, that's where the alligator brain goes. How freaking cool. Okay, so just because they have small brains, though, does not mean they're not smart. I just want to point that out. Sometimes it's not the size of the brain you have, but the amount of the brain that you use. We all know people who have really big brains who don't use all of it. Alligators are really neat, and sometimes people can be really scared of them, but there's really no need. They have a much greater fear of people than we have of them. So some tips for living with alligators. One, never, ever, ever, ever feed an alligator. Why? One, it's illegal, so probably not the best idea. Two, that is how they lose their fear of humans. So when an alligator is fed, they start to associate people with food. They think, huh, that looks like the last thing that gave me food. I'm going to go over there and see if they have any. And that's when bad things happen. So we do not want to feed alligators. We want to give them their space just like snakes. And we never want to handle them just like the snakes. Also, handling an alligator, illegal. So don't do that. You should assume, and it's a pretty safe assumption, that every single body of freshwater in Florida has an alligator in it. And if it doesn't have an alligator today, just wait until tomorrow. Just because there's no alligator in it right now doesn't mean there never ever will be alligators in it. These guys travel, they look for new spots, they show up in weird places in breeding season, which we're coming up on. So May, June time, when they're moving around a lot, be aware. Just assume anything that's freshwater has an alligator in it. Don't allow your dogs or cats to swim or drink from water that may contain alligators, aka pretty much any freshwater. And here's the deal. If you have an alligator and it's hanging out behind your house and it comes up in the yard and maybe it scares you, but it's not really doing anything scary, leave it alone. Because if you get rid of that alligator, that's not really a problem. You might end up with an alligator that moves in that really is a problem. And there's no such thing as a nuisance just because it suns itself on its yard and you go out, or your big dog, keyword on big, because if you send your small dog out to scare the alligator, it's just going to look like a snack. You send your big dog out and that gator just goes right back in the water and swims away and wants nothing to do with you. That's a perfectly healthy, perfectly scared of humans alligator. But if you do have a nuisance gator, things you need to know, you can call this number on your screen. FWC has a hotline, 1-866-FWC-GATOR. Things to know, has to be at least 4 feet long. You cannot just call Uncle Billy Bob to go get the gator, okay? It has to be a licensed alligator trapper, licensed by the FWC department. It also has to pose a genuine threat to people. You have to actually think it's going to come after someone or hurt someone. And know that just because you don't want it in your yard doesn't mean that it'll be relocated somewhere else, okay? The only place it's going is up above to a better place, okay? If you catch what I'm saying. Those gators don't go to some sanctuary somewhere. They may leave your property alive, but that doesn't mean they'll stay alive. So if there's a gator and it's hanging out and it's not bothering anybody, leave it be. If it actually is truly a nuisance to you, your family, your neighborhood, please call and have it removed. All right. Well, that's all I have for you today. If you guys have questions, you can go ahead and leave them in the comment box and we'll go ahead and try to answer as many of them as we can. I appreciate you joining us for today, and I'm going to leave you with a joke, because if we all can't take a moment to just laugh, I don't know what else will get us through. I like to end with incredibly corny, pretty terrible jokes. So here's my last joke for you. What do you call an alligator in a vest? An investigator. You're welcome. If you enjoyed any of the videos and you want the links, here you go. Go ahead and pause it. You can copy those down. Or you can just Google them. They shouldn't be too hard to find. Once again, questions leave in the comments. Hopefully I'll get to see you guys in person soon. I really hope you guys enjoyed that. I look forward to bringing you more presentations like this as we continue on this journey. Bye.